Hello, everyone, and welcome to Somerset and the Invitational. I'm Glenn Jones, joined in the sideboard by Brian Bronduin.
Hello.
Brian, you did okay at the last Invitational, a reasonable finish, nothing to be ashamed of. Yeah, and you were playing in the Legacy Top 8, Esper Deathblade, a deck that has since taken off. Back then it was, you know, a little bit of a newfangled contraption. Now it's that deck everyone's getting kind of tired of seeing on camera.
Right. I think in the Invitational, myself and Javier Arevalo were the only people playing the deck, and now it's just like, you know, kind of the predominant deck for Legacy.
So sure,
it's so really taken off a lot.
Humble brags and all, you know.
Yeah, you know, I have to throw them in there, you know.
The deck is a Jace deck, and it's one of the better ones. But that's all changed now in the new world with the new M14 Legend rules. That changes a lot about how Legacy is going to work. You guys had moved to Geist of St. Trap, for instance, which, you know, you guys weren't playing in the previous Invitational. And, you know, under the new rules also, Jace just no longer eliminates himself. So let's talk about the version you're playing today, because a lot of people started cutting Dark Confidants, but you, and you were among them, in fact, at one point, but now you've gone without the Geists and with the Dark Confidants.
Right. The last time I played the deck, I had Geist, no Dark Confidant, and I realized something that I just don't like Geist of St. Traft. Like, the card is very good in certain games, and it's very good in the mirror match, but it's pretty much bad against almost every other deck in the format.
Okay.
Whereas Dark Confidant is just universally good against pretty much everything, even some of the aggressive decks. Like you really like want a Bob out there just to draw you into like your source of plowshares and things. So I really like Bob, and I think Bob gives the deck more, I guess, velocity, like a more aggressive angle where you can. He makes your turn one death rites better by being able to wasteland your opponent and then playing a 2-drop, either Stoneforge Mystic or a Dark Confidant. And most of the time, your opponent's going to be too far behind to come back from that.
That's definitely an incredibly strong opening. One of the things Geist contributed to was being a blue card, but you have, as you did in the Invitational before, moved your Force of Wills to the sideboard once more.
Right.
You stand behind that decision, obviously, back then, and you're sticking to it now.
Yeah, I'm sticking to it now. There's going to be a ton of fair decks. People in the Invitational really enjoy playing like the very fair decks, so I don't want Force in the main deck because you're just 2-for-1-ing yourself. But I do still want it in my 75 because like when I play against Show and Tell or Storm or whatever, like I have to have access to that card to be able to beat those decks.
It's a valuable effect. Kind of replacing that disruptive element, you've actually added him to Torok to the main deck. A card, you know, you saw do a little bit of work in Shardless Bug. Perhaps a little impressed, wanted some of that for yourself?
That's exactly what it was. Like I played some of Shardless Bug and I was like, wow, him is amazing. I just want to play that card. So I decided to put him in the deck. And it kind of hedges a little bit because it's good against the combo decks, but it's also really good against the other fair decks as just like a 2-for-1. And like sometimes you can strip like 2 lands from their hand and just like really set them back far or something like that. So I like its versatility in those 2 matchups. It's a little slow against some of like the other decks in the format, but those are the decks I don't expect to see a lot of.
Yeah, if you can start with Deathrite Shaman into Wasteland, hemming away some lands is really awkward for the opponent, too.
Right. That also, you know, along with Bob, it plays into, like, the turn 2 thing, where you now have, like, 3 really good cards to play turn 2 along with the Wasteland.
Okay. So. Let's move a little farther up the curve, you know, past 2.
Right.
You're playing a Vindicate main and another Vindicate sideboard. I feel like this card's going to catch on this weekend. Do you agree? I mean, you're playing 2 copies, of course, but it just feels like one of the best answers to Jace that decks like this have available.
I definitely agree. It's one of the best answers to Jace, and it's also very good against cards like Batterskull or Uzo's Jit. Jit has become a lot better now. It's like much harder to remove, so having a Vindicate to kill it is pretty like clutch. So, but yeah, it's definitely like a great answer to Jace, and it also actually goes with the whole Deathrite thing too, of just like you can Stone Rain them on turn 2 sometimes, and then follow it up with the Wasteland on turn 3.
If you're trying to curve your way up into a Jace on 4 mana, that actually, you know, fits in pretty well, I think, being able to turn 3 Stone Rain, turn 4 Jace. You guarantee they can't fire a Jace back at you.
Right.
A lot of things.
A lot of times they're going to have just one guy in play. You can bounce that creature with your Jace, and you're just, you know, the game's over at that point.
Okay. So. Talking about a different Planeswalker, I feel like we've said Jace a lot. Liliana of the Veil. Generally in Legacy, people aren't really stressing themselves over killing a Liliana. You know, you usually just kind of put up with it until you can get rid of it at some point with through attacks or just through it no longer mattering because your board position has gotten really dominant, such as with a Jace.
Yes.
In this deck, it feels like you can use it a little more aggressively, but it also feels like one of the battlefields. You know, now if you're starting with a Liliana, you can have a lot more fight since they can't remove your Jaces. You can get into this like Planeswalker dominant position with like Deathrite Shaman, Planeswalker, Liliana, and Jace.
Yeah, and I started out testing with 2 Lilianas, and actually just within the last 15 minutes I bumped up to 3 because I realized that this card was absolutely the card I wanted to draw the most when I was playing the Deathblade Mirror match, Every draw step, I was like, man, a Liliana would just be awesome here.
Sure.
So I figured if that's the case, I should just be playing three.
Also excellent against Geist of St. Traft, which, you know, now exactly. You have a little bit more trouble removing.
Yeah, now that Geist of St. Traft is like much harder to get rid of, having an extra answer in Liliana, in the third Liliana, just makes a big difference.
Okay.
In Liliana in general. Along, like, you have Swords of Plowshares and Snapcaster Mage to handle all the other guys.
Yeah.
You just need Liliana to take care of the Geist.
All right, well, moving to the sideboard, you have an excellent weapon against Liliana already there. A couple copies of Lingering Soul. Standard, standout. Obviously, it's been very good in Legacy from time to time, as everyone but Jerry would admit.
Yes.
So I assume that's the matchup you primarily want Lingering Souls for, but what are some of the other ones?
Yeah, Lingering Souls is primarily for the Deathblade matchup, but I also like it against like the Shardless Bug deck.
Sure.
It's a way to prevent yourself from losing to like them having a very fast hand with the Tarmogoyf. It also is a good way to pressure their Jaces as well, which can sometimes be very difficult to pressure.
Okay.
Like if they're able to curve like a Shardless Agent into a Tarmogoyf and then play a Jace, a lot of times it's hard to attack the Jace because they have two defenders for it.
That makes a lot of
sense.
So
Lingering Souls is another way to attack the Jace. And I also, I just feel the card's like very good in like those kind of fair matchups. And it's also good against decks like Jund too, things like that. So there's a lot of matchups, but mostly it's for fighting Jace. The primary role.
All right, well, I feel like your sideboard also pays a fair bit of attention to Geist of St. Traft. We've talked about, you know, how it's a little more difficult to remove, but you've got in the sideboard Supreme Verdict and Diabolic Edict. I really like the Edict. Obviously, it plays nicely with Snapcaster Mage as a way to remove multiple Geists if you must. But Supreme Verdict is one I feel like a lot of people want to see coming. I noticed in your playtesting games even, I've seen these boards develop that, you know, players just have like multiple Deathrite Shamans, maybe a Dark Confidant, maybe like a Stoneforge Mystic. And Supreme Verdict seems like an excellent reset in those kinds of situations.
Right, as long as your opponent doesn't have like a Planeswalker advantage on you, Supreme Verdict's a great way to catch back up. So if you can like play a Jace and then they play a Geist, you know, your Jace is just going to die to their Geist, but if you have a Supreme Verdict, now like you get to keep your Jace and so forth. And yeah, it's a great answer to a Geist of St. Traft, and it's also a great reset when you're like, you need to catch back up. So.
All right, well, Brian? Good luck in the rest of the tournament. I know you're in your standard rounds right now. I believe you're playing your revamped reanimator list.
I am, yes.
Well, if you want to hear more about that, you can check out Brian's article, which went up this week. I don't know if you've made any changes from that particular list, but I imagine you have.
Yeah, I made a few, but it's pretty close.
Pretty close. All right, so there you go. A little sneak peek. Thank you for joining me, Brian, and good luck.
Thank you.